What's up, guys? It's James Allen, the out-of-state investor, and today I'm going to be talking about five types of real estate markets that you should avoid investing in. Now, right now, house prices are at all-time highs, interest rates are shooting back up again, and rents have seen some tremendous growth over the last year. But with that said, rents don't normally keep up with house prices, and because of that, along with the fact that interest rates are shooting up again, cash flow has gone down a lot from where it used to be with rental properties. So before I go any further, do me a favor and support the channel by smashing that like button. And if you haven't visited the channel before, I buy rental properties and flip houses both in and out of my state, and I teach you guys how you can build massive wealth doing the same thing yourself. So if that sounds interesting to you, definitely subscribe and hit that notification bell to watch more content like this. And with that said, let's jump into it. All right, so getting started on this, the first type of real estate market you want to avoid investing in is the ultra expensive markets. So I'm talking about the Los Angeles markets, I'm talking about San Francisco, these ultra expensive markets that cost a lot to even get in the game in the first place. Now, the main reason I feel like this is there is a lot of uncertainty right now with the market. Could it keep going higher? Could we be getting closer to a housing crash? We just don't know what's really in the future as far as that's concerned. But what we do know is that these major markets have major swings going up and have major swings going down. So getting in on these markets on what could be the very top of the market could be a bad move, especially if you're just getting started, and not to mention the negative cash flow that often comes with these kind of areas. Like I was mentioning before, cash flow is becoming near impossible to find in many markets that historically actually had cash flow. And so because of that, especially in these ultra expensive markets, it's becoming near impossible without a massive down payment to actually see any kind of cash flow. This hurts you tremendously if you're just getting started and you don't have a portfolio yet where you have other cash flowing rentals maybe to help cover the losses you're getting on these kind of properties. So if you're looking to scale something of significance, it's going to be very hard because lenders look at what your debt to income ratio looks like. And if you're adding debt on top of what you already have, it's going to make it harder for the next property and the next property and the next property if all you're doing is adding negative cash flow with every property you buy. Not to mention that it's hard enough to hold onto a property during a downturn, but at least with positive cash flow, it makes it a lot easier understanding that you're still generating income on a monthly basis with positive cash flow coming through. The second type of market you want to avoid are tenant-friendly markets. In this day and age, buying in a tenant-friendly state is proven to be more costly because you got things like eviction moratoriums taking place. You got a lot of things taking place with the pandemic. And I know people personally that literally haven't received rent payments in over a year because of some of these laws. Now, in general, it's going to be a lot harder to evict tenants in tenant-friendly states than in landlord-friendly states because of the way the laws are set up. You see, in certain tenant-friendly states, I could be waiting months before I can finally evict a tenant for non-payment. Whereas with landlord-friendly states, you may be able to evict a tenant for non-payment in 2 weeks or less. We're talking about the difference of months worth of rent payments, so even for that reason alone, it's worth looking at landlord-friendly states. But aside from that, some states and some markets in particular have rent control. For instance, California has a state rule that you cannot raise rent any higher than 5% in a year beyond what inflation is. Now, you might be thinking that if inflation is currently at 7% and you add 5% to that, 12% in 1 year is not too bad of a raise. But what you got to consider is that sometimes if you're buying a property, especially if you're looking at good deals, you may be buying a property with below market rents. And that's going to be tremendously hard to raise them back to market rent if you're already starting so far behind and you have state rent control in place. These kind of laws have the potential to hurt you over the long run, because imagine if you bought a property and you got a really good deal, let's say on this property, where rents are like $600 a month below market rent, but you can only raise rent 5% over whatever inflation is. You could be looking at years before you can finally get up to whatever market rent is. So you could be looking at tens of thousands of dollars out of your pocket that you missed out on because you weren't able to raise rents up to where they should have been. So when you factor all that in, along with the current conditions of how things are getting even more progressive with some of these rules, I would stay away right now from tenant-friendly states and tenant-friendly markets. The third type of real estate market to avoid investing in is markets with declining populations. Now, when I think of declining populations, St. Louis, Missouri is a city that comes to mind. You see, back Back in 1950, they had a population of about 850,000 people, whereas today the population sits at just over 300,000 people, which means that in the last 70 years, they've lost almost 65% of their entire population. Now, you might be wondering, if something like that happens in a market, what does that do to the values of the homes? Well, if you were to compare a market like St. Louis, Missouri against a market like Tampa, Florida, which has seen some tremendous growth recently, you'll see that back in 2012, they started around a similar price point. According to Zillow, Tampa homes were going for around $117,000, whereas St. Louis, Missouri homes were going for about $103,000. Today, though, St. Louis, Missouri homes go for $161,000, whereas Tampa, Florida homes go for around $354,000. So that means in the last 10 years, we've seen St. Louis, Missouri homes go up 56%, but at the same time, Tampa, Florida homes have more than tripled its value. Now, what you'll see generally with declining populations is the prices are going to go down. Where demand goes down, so do the prices as well. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean prices are going to crash down to zero or anything, but what it does mean is generally the prices aren't going to grow as fast as markets that are seeing growth. Now, that same line of thinking applies to rents as well, because in high growth markets, you don't just see high price growth, you also see big rent growth as well. So just like that, with declining markets, just like you see stagnant price growth, you're also going to see stagnant rent growth as a result. With declining populations, you also run into high occupancy problems because you have an abundance of supply on the market, whereas people are leaving town, so there's less people to occupy those homes, which means that there's more supply than there is demand for that market. So that means you could be looking at longer times as time goes on to fill in those vacancies when people move out of your house. So these are all reasons why you don't want to invest in declining populations, because especially for the long run, the results are not going to be favorable for an investor. The fourth type of market you want to avoid investing in is a market with a struggling economy. So just like we were talking about declining populations, jobs is one of the biggest contributors to population growth. So if you have a lot of jobs coming to a market, generally the population growth follows those jobs. Now the same applies in reverse, whereas if jobs leave a market, then naturally population is also going to leave that market too. Now because of that, you also want to invest in a diverse economy, because you don't want to rely too heavily on one sector, because if you do and that one sector leaves, then you could be looking at a massive population decline. Now when I think of a local economy failing and how it relied so heavily on just one industry, I think of the city of Detroit and how it relied so heavily on the automotive industry. Back in 1950, Detroit had a population of over 1.8 5 million people, making it one of the biggest cities in all of America. Today, it only sits at about 674,000. You see, what happened is Detroit relied so heavily on the automotive industry, and many major auto plants ended up leaving, which ended up causing major job loss, which then caused major population decline over the past decades. Now, Detroit still sees population decline even to this day, and because of that, it's actually reflected in the type of growth that takes place in house prices. Detroit has seen, on average, less than 1% appreciation per year over the last 22 years, and a big reason for this has been the massive decline in population, which was originally caused by their struggling economy. So as you can see, these are the things that can heavily play into the success of your real estate investments, so try to avoid investing in places that don't have a diverse economy, and also avoid investing places where job growth is weak and the overall economy is struggling. Now the fifth type of market you want to avoid investing in is high vacancy markets. Now obviously the main reason you want to avoid investing in high vacancy markets is because if your property's vacant, it's not making you any kind of money. We rely on tenants to pay rent, which is how landlords make their money. So if you're investing in high vacancy markets, you're already ruining your investment from the start by killing all the cash flow that you would have made. Now aside from that, by having a vacant property or investing in places where you're going to be vacant for periods on end, the problem you're going to run into is theft and vandalism. People will want to break into your house, steal your AC units, steal your appliances, and you could be out thousands of dollars aside from the lost rent just from people stealing equipment in your house. Now at the same time, you also run the risk of squatters in your house. That's just people that don't pay you rent, but they live in your house anyway. And if they live there long enough without you knowing about it, depending on the market, they will earn certain rights that allow them to stay there as their home, and it could become a nightmare trying to get them out of there. So how do you determine what your vacancy rate is? Well, you just simply take your number of vacant days and divide it by the number of possible rentable days. So if it's available all year long, that'd be 365 available rental days. You would take the number of vacant days, let's say is vacant 30 days of the year, you divide it by the 365 days, and that would give you your vacancy rate. Now you might be wondering, well, how do I find out what the vacancy rate is for my market? Well, in my opinion, opinion, the best way to do this is talk to your property manager because they deal with this on a daily basis. They're going to be the best resource to get really specific to know if this particular neighborhood or this particular street is a good or bad one for rental properties. But if you're just wanting a general overview of a market to see what the rental vacancy is like in that market, the U.S. Census Bureau actually publishes quarterly statistics keeping track of this. So that could be a good way to start, get a general overview by looking at the U.S. Census Bureau data, and then once you've chosen a market, talk to your property manager and get a little more specific on which neighborhoods may be good with lower vacancy rates. Now, I typically invest in markets where my vacancy rates are under 5%, and that's going to guarantee me that I'm not going to have a hard time finding a tenant whenever my house goes vacant. So anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. These are 5 markets you want to avoid investing in. And if you enjoyed today's video and you feel like you gained some value, do me a favor and support the channel by smashing that like button. And if you haven't already done so, definitely subscribe and hit that notification bell to watch more content like this. Also, let me know in the comments below if you enjoyed today's content or if you have any questions, and I'll do my best to get back to you. Finally, follow me on Instagram and TikTok @TheOutOfStateInvestor. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.